I want to bring on Ross Gerber. Gerber Kawasaki Wealth and Investment Management CEO joins us once again on the show. And Ross, always good to have you on, man. I mean, we'll start with crypto. We can broaden out to the market. But, you know, there's a lot of Bitcoin bugs who have been talking about inflation and how it's all due to the fact that the U.S. keeps printing cash. But, you know, they might be overlooking the supply crunch that's happening here, too. So what do you make of where Bitcoin's at, given kind of the 30% pullback we've seen?
Well, I don't see any correlation between Bitcoin and inflation in the United States, but the pullback in Bitcoin is really a byproduct of its very high price and the fact that it's had such a great year. You know, most people in the stock market now think long term is, you know, 2 weeks. And so with crypto being a 24/7 asset, it kind of compresses this like short-termism mentality that really gets in the way from making smart investments. We buy Bitcoin on every dip. We buy Ethereum on every dip. This is a long-term, high-risk investment for investors. If you want to be a part of the digital currency of the future, you buy and hold these assets. If you trade them, you're playing a very difficult game. But I cannot be more bullish about the crypto ecosystem in the next decade.
Yeah, just to follow on that too, I mean, are you looking to maybe start to broaden out beyond Bitcoin and Ether? Obviously, you know, there's a lot of questions as you get further and further down the line in some of these assets, but now it's been interesting to watch correlations start to break from some of those too. I'm thinking about Terra, we've had that founder on a few times, and some of the other, products in the crypto space, but there's still security questions, and the SEC hasn't really given any guidance there.
Right. So you've got two big questions in there. One is, what are these other coins worth? And most of them are worthless. We did this with the ICOs in the last cycle in 18. You know, in 2018, we started a crypto index, and it was coins over 10 billion. And our index started at 1,000 at the top, 1118. And it went down to about 200 when the market declined. And basically, all those other coins died pretty much, except for maybe Bitcoin Cash. And Bitcoin and Ethereum are like cockroaches. They're just not going to die. And so, you know, they've come back, and now that index sits around 3,500 for us. You know, so Bitcoin, Ethereum has been the best way to play these assets over the long term versus many of the other coins that are sort of get rich quick coins. Some of the coins we like, maybe like the Binance coin, that have utility. But if you can't ascribe direct utility to the coin and you just start telling me it's proof of stake or proof of this or proof of that, I don't want anything to do with it, because I'm a long-term investor and it's got to be here when the next crypto winter comes, which will come. So beware, crypto NFT lovers. Crypto winter come, and they're brutal. And they're brutal. So we're in the core assets, and that's where I think investors should be long-term.
Ross, I think that's the first time I've heard a comparison to cockroaches. Did you just say that Bitcoin and Ethereum are like cockroaches?
Yeah, Bitcoin is more of a cockroach. You know, Ethereum's gotten beaten up a little bit more. Bitcoin, you can't kill it. You know, I started in Bitcoin in 2014, and at the time I thought it was a scam, and I thought it was going to die, and all the things that a lot of people today still think. And fortunately, I was converted by my very smart friends who convinced my traditional financial mind to think bigger. And in the 7 years, I've watched them almost get killed several times, and they continue to survive just like cockroaches have for thousands, if not millions of years.
Ross, I have to ask you about some of your other conviction plays. I don't know if you heard our previous guest talking about, you know, some of the growth names that could be hit hard with the rates going up. I know you've been bullish on Tesla, but now you've got the likes of Cathie Wood, who are saying that she's going through some soul searching because of where the market's headed, and the fact that some of her holdings are down as well. Are you still bullish on that? And are you worried about the ability, not just of Tesla, but some of these other higher growth names, to be able to ride out a higher rate environment?
Well, Cathie's having a real bad time right now. You know, she's been doing horribly for her shareholders over the last 6 months, and I feel bad for, I'm one of them. So, you know, I feel bad for me. Not a big one, fortunately, but you know, I believe in innovation, and innovation and the way they invest is 100% off the future and 0% off valuations. And so I can certainly see her readjusting her viewpoint of certain positions, Tesla being the one I'm least concerned of any stock I have ever owned. I have never seen a company dominate, be in such a, even Apple with Steve Jobs in the cusp of the iPhone days wasn't as dominant as Tesla is today in the markets that they're in. The one thing that I don't spend any time worrying about at all is Tesla. Okay. Now, when you talk about high growth names that don't have rapidly rising earnings and wonderful products and services that are changing the world, and I'm paying a huge multiple for that innovation, I would be concerned in a higher rate environment.
I just realized you upgraded your mic too, so we got to comment on that. But when you look at maybe the other things out there, Ross, and you know, year-end plays and what investors should know about kind of rebalancing. I saw you kind of tweeting about, you know, selling and buying versus other strategies here at the end of the year when it comes to taxes. I guess what's the main takeaway that maybe retail investors who jumped in maybe this year should know about maybe what their plan should be when it comes to taxes?
Well, tax loss harvesting is super effective for every reason. You go through your portfolio. This is what I do, what I'll do, you know, in a few minutes, and what I've been doing every day. And I have losers, you know, I, you know, some of the stocks we buy go down. We bought some Square, it's gone down, you know, so I can tax loss harvest that, move it into something like ARC F, which is the same exact exposure. And so I don't change my exposure, but I'm able to take that tax loss. Not every investment we make goes up right away, but there's ways to benefit from that. One great trade is moving your losers and selling them and moving into my fund, GK, which gives you lots of diversified exposure. And that's the way I'm running my fund right now. And I think people should pay attention to the diversification in their portfolios. We have a very large real estate component. We're heavily weighted in real estate in positions like Home Depot and Lennar, Blackstone, IIPR. That's done very well for us. So I think when you look at innovation, you look at all these exciting areas of technology, but then you don't look at many other areas of the market that present opportunities like real estate. Investors have more volatility and lower returns over time. But I'm not convinced that we're going to see very high rates for quite some time. So I'm still quite bullish despite all the interest rate talk.
Yeah. And lastly, Ross, I don't know how big of a piece of your portfolio it is, but you and I have obviously talked quite a bit about cannabis names out there. Those still have not recovered. There was a lot of optimism we might get safe banking this year. It doesn't look like it's going to happen. So I imagine those might be some of the losers you could be selling here. I mean, what's the strategy around those names if it is to sell them now year end and then kind of get back in, because Democrats haven't been able to get the job done there on changing the law?
Yeah, you know, it's the most disappointing part of my portfolio. So half of our cannabis exposure is like MSOS positions, which are multi-state operators in the U.S. And then the other half is really this IIPR. So the IIPR has done phenomenal. Phenomenal. The real estate portion of cannabis has done great, but the actual MSOs, which fundamentally their businesses are doing really well, the valuations have been crushed because the Democrats can't seem to move on to legalization. But I think this is going to happen next year, and I don't really care that it didn't happen this year, because now I'm looking at some of the best opportunities I've ever seen in the growth cannabis names, and I haven't pulled the trigger yet to go all in on these names, but some of them I will at some point soon. And obviously I'm not going to tell you until after I do it, but I think some of the valuations are absurdly cheap now, but I still see several challenges in getting institutional ownership of these securities. And it's all around safe banking and the ability to list on the US exchanges, so institutional investors can own them. So then those stocks triple. So I just think it's a 2022 story now. You know, that's where we're at. It's a great opportunity. I haven't taken it yet.
Okay, well, we'll have to have you back on in 2022 to see where your portfolio is headed. Ross, always good to talk to you. Ross Gerber, Gerber Kawasaki Wealth and Investment Management CEO.